Ramo, Ramo, Hare, Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare, Hare, Hare Ramo, Hare Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna. Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare Krishna, Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare. Yeah. Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama Rama Hare 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 Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama.
Hare Rama, Rama Rama, So we're going to discuss a little bit about balance, and then we're going to do a little exercise. So I've defined, I think, for devotees, six areas, which are important for us to balance. And there's a balance between all these areas, and there's a balance, it can be balanced within the area, because you can be out of balance in a particular area, and even be in balance with all areas, which means you're giving equal attention to all areas, but within one area, something could also be out of balance. And sometimes being out of balance in different areas of our life reflects our own imbalance. We may be like workaholics, so then the work will get more energy. Or we may be very into sadhana to the extreme that some other area is neglected. Or we might do so much service that we neglect our family. Or we might spend so much time with our family that we neglect our service, or we don't do any service. So the idea of this discussion is to see if there are any areas of our life that are out of balance. And out of balance would mean that it's adverse. One area of our life is could be adversely affecting another area. And it doesn't mean that we're not doing well in one area. Like, let's say, for example, you're very healthy. So we have health as one area here. So you put so much time into your health. Maybe you spend 6 hours a day. You run for 2 hours in the morning, run for 2 hours in the evening, do an hour of yoga in the morning, hour of yoga in the evening. You're spending lots of time cooking because everything has to be just perfect. And you're super healthy. And you can say, from the point of view of health, you're a success. But you've neglected your family. You have no time for your family because all your time is spent doing yoga and running. And so there's a saying, which I'd like you to read, or a question: are you succeeding by failing? And so this is very important. And it's a question you have to ask yourself. Are you succeeding by failing means, in this example, it would mean, have you succeeded in your health by failing in some other area of your life? So let's say, like, my family relationship is disrupted because I don't have time to spend with them because I'm concerned about my health. Or let's say, we can use this example, let's say my career is health because I want to enter the Olympics. So now my family, I'm working out and my family is being neglected. So I'm successful. I've been chosen for the Olympics. I'm very healthy, I'm successful. My family's destroyed. So I have succeeded in my health by failing in my family. Does that make sense? So that's the meaning of succeeding by failing. Not that failure is a pillar to success. This is a different point. This is that I've succeeded because I failed to do something else. Right? So we want to look at that. And in order to look at it, I think we need to talk about each one of these individual sections to understand how much time and energy we should put into them and what's their importance. So, I have them in a balance here. They're all the same size. Now, it's going to be up to you to determine if you want them all the same size. Health may be a little smaller, may not take as much time as family or work. But the idea of the balance here is not necessarily the amount of time, but the quality. Is that all right? It's the quality. So you might put 1 hour into your family, and you have a great family, and that's all you need, but you need to put 4 hours into sadhana. If you don't, you won't be Krishna conscious. But you're not taking time out from your family to find time for sadhana. Okay, so we kind of want to discuss these each area is to give you an idea of how much time and effort you think you'll need. So, where should we start? Should we just go the order that it's in? Sadhana, seva, family, health?
Yes.
Okay, sadhana. For us, if you're living in the world, you're working, going to school, for us, sadhana primarily means, or foremost, is our japa. That's our main sadhana. And reading and doing some puja. That's our main sadhana. Right? Well, you could say that's the main sadhana for everybody, but when you're living at home, sometimes there's no puja. Sometimes there's not so much reading, but there's definitely japa. So japa is, if you had to stop everything, you wouldn't stop japa. You'd stop reading, maybe puja, whatever, but japa. So japa is the main thing. Can we agree on that? Or you know, if you had to eliminate something, it wouldn't be, well, okay, I could eliminate my reading a half hour, I could eliminate my puja 20 minutes, or I could eliminate 8 rounds. Which one should I do? No, that wouldn't be, if you're initiated, that wouldn't be a question. So sadhana means 16 good rounds every day, and then ideally reading every day, and for many of you, some deity worship. What else? What else do we do with our sadhana? Deity worship, Tulsi worship. So that's basically our sadhana.
Listening.
Hearing, yeah, reading or hearing lectures, yeah. When we say sadhana, we specifically mean when you're not doing anything else. Like, you know, you're listening to a class and you're like taking notes. Or sadhana could be journaling, writing your realization, something contemplative and deep. So here's my realization about the morning. I think the morning is a time of day that Krishna has given to us as his very special gift. That's the gift to all of us, the morning. And if you sleep late, you don't get to open up the gift. Because the gift is the morning. Because in the morning, what can you do in the morning that you can't do at another time of day? You can think better in the morning, right? I don't recommend that you get up at 5 o'clock and think about your business, but if you did, you'd probably think more clearly than you would at 3 in the afternoon. In fact, I don't bring in details, but there are studies like this. So, when we're balancing sadhana with our other activities, then ideally the balance would be that I could go to bed early, that none of these other activities, ideally, would keep me up so late that I can't have good sadhana in the morning. Okay? Now, there's one thing I just would want to relate to you. It's a tip on how to chant japa, but it will illustrate this point of sadhana. A lot of people, probably all the devotees, ask, how do I control my mind during japa? And one of the things I discovered is that if during japa you mentally have not started your day, in other words, today is Sunday, right? So let's say you woke up this morning and you started chanting, but in your mind it wasn't Sunday. It's just the day hadn't started. So let's say your normal day, like for us, our day started at 7:15. We left Saki Roy's house at 7:15. So for me, that means I had to get ready before we go. So I got up in the morning, I chanted my rounds, and then I got ready. So I got ready maybe like 6:30. So my day didn't start till 6:30. So I was chanting from about 4 o'clock. So I could chant peacefully because I didn't have to think about my day, because in my mind, my day hadn't started. Sunday doesn't exist till I finish my rounds. For most of us, the day exists as soon as we get up, isn't it? And it's kind of, we're planning the day. So let's say, for the sake of discussion, all of you have to start your day at 7 o'clock, take bath or prepare your breakfast, get dressed and go to work. Let's say you start at 7. So that means you get up, whatever you get up. You get up in sufficient time to do your puja, to chant your rounds. And in your mind, you're thinking, my day doesn't start till 7. It just doesn't. I have the whole morning. Morning's a vacation. There's nothing to do. That's the value of the morning, right? Let's say your day starts at 7 and you get up at 6. What are you thinking about when you're chanting your japa? If you haven't gotten dressed, you might be thinking about what you're going to wear. Or what you have to do at work, or what you're going to have for breakfast. So, the beauty of getting up early is if you get up enough hours before your day starts, your day actually hasn't started. You have, that's just your time for hearing and chanting and meditating. And the morning is in Sattvaguna, and Sattvaguna is the best time to chant. Right? So whenever I think of the word sadhana, I just think early morning. They're like, to me it's synonymous, because that's when you do your sadhana. And that's Krishna's gift. I may be in the mode of passion, I may be in the mode of ignorance, but the morning is in the mode of goodness. So I'm up early in the morning. It's good, and I can prove this with a story. When I was young, we used to get up very early in the morning to do austerities and penances called surfing in the winter. So I remember this to this day. It impacted me so much. And I wasn't Krishna conscious then, but it impacted me. So we went over to the house of our friend. I guess we all rode our bikes or he picked us up or something. But I remember being in our friend's van. There were like four or five of us. And we were going to drive like an hour and a half early. It was about five or six in the morning. And this friend who was driving was really a wild, wild guy. It was like totally wild. So it's like 5 in the morning. He turns the radio on, right? Rock and roll music. And all of us were 16-year-old, you know, California surfers. We said, turn the radio off. It's too early for that music. Even we, California hippie rock and roll surfers, couldn't stand to hear rock and roll at 5 in the morning because there was so much sattva at 5 in the morning. There's so much shanti, shanti. So that's Krishna's gift. No matter who you are, where you are, what you are, if you're up in the morning, you have shanti, shanti. And every hour you're up in the morning before you have to start your day is just gold. It's like that's the best hour of the day, isn't it? So the idea of sadhana, I see it like an inoculation. Every morning I have to get my inoculation because I'm going out and the world's contaminated. And if I get that inoculation, it gives me protection from the modes of nature and it gives me strength. Right? So that's the value of sadhana. So certainly none of these other things should in any way, in general, inhibit our sadhana as a general principle. Okay. So now, the next one is seva. So the natural question is, but what if I have to stay up late at night doing seva? Good question. Were you thinking of that? Okay, I'll tell you another story. After I became very concerned about my japa, having attended many japa retreats, I began to understand that so many things that I was doing in the day were actually affecting my japa, especially what I was doing at night. Because what I was doing at night was determining what time I go to bed. And I may do something innocent at night, like finish some emails or whatever. It keeps me up till like 10:30 or 11, when I actually could have gone to bed at 9. So I've lost like an hour and a half, or maybe 2 hours. And before I did the japa workshops, I wouldn't think so much about it, not at least in relation to japa. But once I did the japa workshops, I started thinking, if I now go on my computer, even if I tell myself I'm just going to go on for 15 minutes, that's a big lie. Because I know I never go on for 15 minutes, I go on longer, so I'm probably going to stay up another hour or two. So formerly I wouldn't think so much about it. After doing the japa workshops, immediately I connected, this is affecting my japa. This is going to affect my japa because I'm going to get up an hour later, which means I'm going to chant 8 rounds instead of 16 tomorrow morning, or I'm going to be starting chanting an hour closer to where my day starts. And as you know, the closer your day starts, the more your mind gets involved in your day, right? If you're chanting at 5, you can be peaceful. At 6:30, your japa is about the day, isn't it? So I'm not giving an answer which is you should stay up late or you shouldn't. Just to consider, you may have service that keeps you up late. Is there a way that you don't have to stay up late? Now, I have god brothers who have very strict principles. They don't do late night programs. They don't do these, you know, late night, finish at 9, take prasadam, get home, full belly, 10:30 programs. They may do them occasionally, but in general, they don't. And they don't recommend it for other people. So it's something to think about, right? I was in a temple in the Middle East. Their programs all end about 9:30 at night, and then they take prasadam. So it might be the only way they can do it, but if there was another way to do it, it would be better, I think. You agree? Yeah. So, now, one of the things I've seen is the connection between seva and family, a problem that's come up. And one of the problems is that people who are busy only have weekends free to do seva. So there has to be a balance there, because people who are busy, I don't know how, if you work like they do in America, like 11, you know, between driving to work and working, like 12 hours a day, or you work less here? 8 or 9, oh, you're lucky, yeah. In India and America, it's like, well, any IT guys here? You work longer or same? Oh yeah, you're lucky. Yeah, because, yeah. Okay, so this is less of a problem for you. But most of the time people have for family is the weekend, and that's the time they have for service. And sometimes devotees who've been very enthusiastic for service have gone to the temple on Saturday, like, you know, for Bhagavatam class, and just stayed all day, did service all day. And then same thing on Sunday, and they were never at home. So it created a problem with the family, right? So that's one thing to consider. That's one problem. The opposite problem would be the other extreme, that I don't do any service because I want to spend time with the family. Now, we want to talk a little bit about Prabhupada and his mood and how giving Krishna consciousness to other people is not just service, but it's actually part of our sadhana also. So, and how families also can engage together. They want to spend time. They can engage in service together, and they can engage in spreading Krishna consciousness because it's fun. So, just so you understand that when we talk about service, it's not just service at the temple, but we also have service in bringing Krishna consciousness to others. And that service is very important, not just for others, but more importantly, it's for us, is very important. Because Prabhupada said, when you're giving Krishna, you're getting Krishna. And so one of the easiest ways to experience Krishna consciousness is to share it with other people. And so we should also look at sharing not only as service, but as sadhana as well. We need that. Have any of you experienced that? That giving Krishna consciousness is like a sadhana for you? It's like an oxygen? Yeah. Like we have kirtan in the temple. It's very blissful. Harinam Sankirtan, when it's given to other people, is more blissful. Because not only are we getting it, we're sharing it. And when you share it, it comes back in greater proportion. Yes? When you give knowledge, your knowledge increases. Your realization increases. right? And when you're given knowledge, you become duty-bound to give it also. And it's said that if a Brahmin doesn't give knowledge, his knowledge will dry up because he's duty-bound to give it. That's his obligation. So it's kind of funny when you look at it that way. That means if you come to the temple and you listen to classes, then you become duty-bound to give it. That becomes an obligation. And anyway, that's what Prabhupada wanted from us. And the other thing that is, it is so beneficial about giving Krishna consciousness is that it helps us to get out of our self-centeredness, because we have to do something maybe that's not comfortable, or maybe something that's a little austere, but it's for the benefit of other people. And that increases our compassion. The other day we were talking about how you practice an action and then it develops. Maybe you know this story that Bhurijan Prabhu was asking Prabhupada, how do you develop compassion? And then Prabhupada said, you serve the movement of compassion. So you may not have it, but you do the compassionate activity. So you share Krishna consciousness, you share books, you share the holy name in Harinam. And it actually increases your compassion. And it does many, many things. It helps you become more equipoised, because there's so many different people that you can share with, and we really shouldn't discriminate. If they're Australian or Indian or man, woman, young or old, we should. So it causes us to stop seeing people as bodies. That's part of the value of spreading Krishna consciousness. You have to see people as spiritual beings. Anyone have that experience in spreading Krishna consciousness? If you don't see that way, it impedes your ability to spread Krishna consciousness. So, another thing that sharing Krishna consciousness does is it causes you or forces you to learn Krishna consciousness, because if you're going to share it, you have to know it. Has any of you ever shared Krishna consciousness? Someone asked you a question, you couldn't answer it, you went home, went through the books, you're like, how do I answer this? It forces you to learn. And another thing it does is it forces you to live it, because how can you tell somebody to do something that you're not doing? It doesn't feel good, does it? How can a fat person tell people not to eat much? How can one who eats sweets tell people not to eat sweets? How can one who doesn't rise early tell people to rise early? You really can't. So sharing Krishna consciousness forces us to become an example. So it's good if we see sharing Krishna consciousness not as something I will do if I have time, but something that I actually need to do for my own personal benefit. And you may remember that when Prabhupada's spiritual master told him to preach, he said, not only is it good for the people that you'll be preaching to, what else did he say? It'll be good for you also. And so it's interesting that he said that. He said, this will be good for you. Spread Krishna consciousness to the West. That was his order. But later on he said, it'll be good for them, it'll be good for you. And that's true. So we should see sharing Krishna consciousness as a sadhana. We can share it somehow or other. And you can share it informally, or you can share it formally through Harinam Sankirtan or book distribution. Now, I can just tell you a little history. I was involved with book distribution for many years. And one of the things that I noticed in temples where book distribution and Harinam were going on, the energy was higher. And the reason the energy was higher is because when we go out and share it, we become enthused. And it was so funny. I was in this temple in Vancouver, Canada. Vancouver, Canada, it's like on the same... It's like you have London. Yeah, London. Yeah, it's like a straight line across London and Vancouver. It's kind of dark and cold. And we were all very young devotees. And often the weather was not nice. And we were going out every day on the street and chanting. for maybe 6 hours. It was so hard to get the devotees out the door. I just basically had to whip them. Nobody wanted to go. Every morning we would go around 10 o'clock. So hard to get them out. And every morning, every evening we would come back at 6 o'clock. And it was so hard to get them back. And this repeated itself every day for like 6-8 months. I could hardly get them out and I could hardly get them back. Because when you're sharing Krishna consciousness, you become inspired. And so I distinctly remember coming back from Sankirtan in the evenings, a group of us, brahmacharis, and then having evening aarti. And we would dance like madmen. Because we were so inspired by preaching. And we'd have these just amazing aartis. And you couldn't have an aarti like that unless you'd gone out all day and distributed books. You wouldn't be feeling that. So there was an energy that came into the temple when the Sankirtan was going on. Everyone was very inspired. And people got along better because now our consciousness was about helping other people. So it seemed we had less problems. And devotees would always say, when I do Sankirtan, I forget my problems because now I'm dealing with other people's problems. That was a constant theme, you know. We all have problems, but we tend to forget our problems when we're helping other people with their problems. So in so many ways it's helpful to us individually, and so many ways it's helpful to the temple, not only because new people are coming and learning about Krishna, but we become inspired. Does that make sense? Any of you experienced that? Inspiration? So just as we said, the early morning is a very special time. Having the opportunity to share Krishna consciousness is very special. And even I live in Mayapur, which is very special. Sometimes I get a little antsy to go out and share Krishna consciousness. I feel I need to do that. And I'm living in Mayapur, which Prabhupada said is the most sacred place in the universe. I think, why would you want to leave the most sacred place? I want to leave to share it because I feel I need to for my own Krishna consciousness. So that's something to consider. And if you're not sharing directly, then Prabhupada said that you should think in all the service you're doing that indirectly it's sharing. It's still part of Sankirtan. As you're doing the deity worship, people will come, see the deities, the devotees will see the deities, they'll become inspired. You're cooking for the devotees who will go out and share Krishna consciousness. So everything's related to spreading it. So the kind of the heartbeat of the Hare Krishna movement is Sankirtan, is sharing Krishna consciousness. And the temple becomes more, you could say, resuscitated. They have a Sankirtan's like a triple bypass. It just, the heart of the temple starts pumping more. So it's very important as a community to share in these activities. So when there's opportunities for sharing Krishna consciousness, even if you feel a little reluctant, it'll be a great contribution to the community. The more of us that go out, the more we inspire one another. And you will be inspired, even if you might be like those brahmacharis who have to get kicked out the door and thrown in the van and strapped in the seat so they don't jump out the window on the way. But when you get out there, you may just want to stay out and you'll have so much fun. So I just wanted to kind of express how our movement was in the beginning. It was a Sankirtan movement. Everything was about sharing. And all the life and energy of the temple was in sharing. That's where we got the impetus to do everything, was from sharing. Okay. Any questions on those? We've done sadhana seva. Any questions on that? You can bring your kids out. Your kids will distribute more books than you, because nobody can refuse a kid. Right? So you let them do all the work and you just stand there. And people are happy to take books and help children. So we mentioned a little bit about family. Family is an ashram, grihastha ashram. So most people here are family members. So the purpose of ashram is to get shelter from the material world. purpose of ashram is a place where we can execute peacefully our sadhana, right? So we call it the Grihastha ashram. We don't call it the Griha Kurukshetra ashram. That is counterproductive. The home, that when the home becomes the battlefield, then it becomes counterproductive to what the ashram is. The ashram is the place where you go for your sanctity, where you go for your spiritual development. Right? That's what ashram means. So that means it takes time to cultivate the Grihastha ashram, and it takes energy so that we can create this foundation. Now, my personal experience is that if you don't put enough time into the Grihastha ashram, it turns into the battlefield of Kurukshetra. Their relationships, they require time, and they just don't develop without time. Your kids need time, the wife needs time, the husband needs time. And I think anyone who's married understands this. And we have the word quality time, right? It means time which is creating relationship, good relationship. So that's the basis of Grihastha ashram, good relationships, and good relationships create a foundation so that you can be happy and peaceful at home. And when you go out in the crazy, turbulent world, you can deal with it. But if your life at home is turbulent, and you go out into the turbulent world, you're getting knocked from both sides. And it's very difficult. People who have difficult lives, difficult careers, and have difficult lives at home, it's very hard to make it in their careers. Have you seen that? Yeah. At least if you love your work and it's peaceful, you could tolerate your home. If you don't like your work and your home is peaceful, you can tolerate your work. But if both are not peaceful, then you're really in trouble. So, sometimes, I'm just saying this because sometimes devotees will think, well, putting time into the Grihastha ashram is like a waste of time because I could be putting time into service. And this came up with Prabhupada. One of the pujaris had a child, and she couldn't really do her pujari service anymore. And she said to Prabhupada, I can't do my service because of my child. And Prabhupada said, no, your child, now your child is your deity, so your child is now your service. So, family is also service. So if I say, I don't have time for my family because I have service, then you could say, I don't have time to chant japa because of my service. And we used to say that in the early days. We wouldn't finish 16 rounds because we thought service was more important. And that meant japa wasn't service. So when we'd say service and japa, we meant two different things. Japa is not service. So don't think that Grihastha life is not service. So it's also service. And you want to do what is necessary to keep the Grihastha ashram happy, stable, and a place from which you can grow, because that's the whole point of Grihastha ashram. It's a place from which you grow in Krishna consciousness. And if you're not growing in Krishna consciousness at home, it means something's wrong. And whatever, I don't know what it is, because it could be wrong for different people. But whatever it is, we need to address it and make it right, because that's the place from which we're meant to grow. So it is service. It's an ashram. It's your service. Let's say a sannyasi were having difficulty, we would think it's his service to solve the difficulty, wouldn't we? Wouldn't you think like that? Maharaj, this is now your service is to stabilize your ashram. Yes? So same with Grihastha. Stable, keep it a place from which you can advance. It is service. Any questions on that? Yes?
Even though, my family is absolutely complete, very good, I still have very high expectations of them. What do I do?
High expectations for their spiritual lives or material lives? Mm-hmm. Is that you're asking? Is that good or bad or
good? What do I do?
What are you doing? You take birth in America, and then you, as a parent, you won't have that problem. As an Indian, I don't think you can do anything. I mean, you could kill yourself. That would solve the problem, but other than that. Okay, we have to actually give an answer to this. Sometimes expectations are good, and sometimes expectations are demeaning because you don't give. It's like I have to tell you what to become, and then you'll think, well, you don't think I have, you know, the impetus and inspiration and intelligence to know what to become and how to do it. So sometimes it can have a counter effect. You know, expectations are sometimes good and sometimes bad. If you have no expectation, I had this situation with my daughter, and you know, I'd look at her and I'd say, you know, I think you should be this, just studying her nature, and her reply was, I'll figure it out, you don't have to tell me, you know. And my daughter's very smart, and so naturally one of the concerns of parents are that their kids will be spiritually advanced and materially secure. So my conclusion was, you give them everything, like here are the cards, here's how to play the cards, and then let them play. At some point you let them play, because you've already given them the instruction. If they play them wrong, they'll learn that was the wrong card. And you could say, I told you that was the wrong card. And they can say, I wanted to figure it out myself. I realized that my daughter's just like me. She wants to figure things out herself. So if you tell her it's like this, she'll just say, you don't have to tell me, I'll figure it out. And that's the way I was with my father. He couldn't tell me anything. And he told me that. He said, I don't tell you anything because I can't. And it wasn't that I was stubborn, it's just my nature is to figure it out myself. Like, you know, give me some software. I never read the manual. It's just not my nature to read. That's my last resort, is the manual. You know, you just like I never took a guitar lesson, I never took a mridanga lesson, I never took a harmonium lesson. You just figure it out. That's my nature. And so I realized that's her nature also. So I can't. But we've given her the tools. And you know, she'll make some mistakes, but human beings sometimes can't learn things if they don't make mistakes. That's just part of the process. So yeah. You want to hear a story? How many of you heard of Deepak Chopra? Deepak Chopra. He likes Prabhupada, so, you know. He may say things which philosophically we may not agree with entirely, but he liked Prabhupada, so that's good. And many of the things he teaches are in line with what we teach. He said, he was very, very much of the idea of encouraging his children to find their dharma and go with it. So he said to his children, he said, you can do anything you want in life and I'll support you. Which meant in every way, including money. He says, you don't have to worry about money, you can do anything you want in your life. He said, their second year in college they were filthy rich because they both found something they liked to do and they made money with it. So I think that's our duty as parents, to facilitate, you know, the growth and let them achieve what they need to achieve. Otherwise you have the Three Idiots movie. You've seen it? Three Idiots? But your kids will end up like the Three Idiots. Right? Suicide, you know. How many have not seen the movie Three Idiots? Oh. Your life is completely wasted. Anyway, it was a social commentary about people being forced into an education in engineering, and they're not engineers. And their parents have come from a poor village and saved all their money so their kids could become engineers. And one kid killed himself because he... Why did he kill himself? Because he turned in his final exam late, and he couldn't let his parents down because they relying on him. And one kid tried to kill himself because he wasn't an engineer. He didn't want to do engineering. He wanted to do something else. And that was his calling. So, one thing that I find interesting about this, you know, I make jokes, you know. If you're born in an Indian family, your occupation is determined in the womb, and there are only four choices. Doctor, engineer, lawyer, or accountant, something like that. Right? And computer programmer. Yeah. So, on their birthday, you give them a little card that says, choose one of these five. Anything else, you know. And then she grows up and says, Daddy, I want to be an artist. I just want to paint. And then immediately has a heart attack. You know. But what I find so funny about that is that the Bhagavad Gita doesn't teach that. It doesn't teach that you choose from five occupations. It teaches you choose according to their nature, right? And so, if you plant something in the backyard, you could plant carrots, potatoes, tomatoes, ginger. You can plant so many things, right? Modern education is planting about two crops, engineering and computer science, right? And education could produce so much, and all the seeds out there are not engineering and computer science and doctors and lawyers and accountants. That's not all the seeds. There are lots of seeds out there. And that's a defect of modern education. So, would you like to hear a story? This is a Varnashram story that came from someone who doesn't even know what Varnashram is. There was a lady who was, I don't know if I told you the story. Did I tell you a story about the lady who became a ballet teacher? She was brought to a psychiatrist because she had learning disabilities. She couldn't sit in her chair. She was very active. So she was brought to the psychiatrist. This was before ADHD was discovered. And before the pharmaceutical companies decided to call a normal kid, decided to label a normal child with attention deficit disorder, because that way they could make a drug and sell it through the psychiatrist, convince them to give the drug. So that was before this happened. So this psychiatrist didn't know what ADHD was or ADD because the pharmaceutical companies hadn't invented that disease yet. Don't get any ideas of inventing disease and coming up with drugs for a business plan. But that's basically one of the things they did here. So anyway, she went to psychologist. So the psychologist said, he heard the mother, he talked to the girl. He said, ma'am, can I speak to you in the next room? So they went to the next room. When he was leaving the office, he told the girl, stay in the office, and he put some music on. And in the next room, there was a glass window so they could see in the next room. So in the next room, she was dancing. He played the music, and he knew she was going to do this because he understood that she actually was a dancer, and that's why she couldn't focus in school, because she was kinesthetic intelligent, not intellectual or accounting, mathematical intelligence or engineering intelligence. She was kinesthetic. So they'd be sitting in class, and she'd be moving around like this. So he understood that. He said, your daughter is a dancer. That's why she's in the wrong school. He said, enroll her in dance school. So she was enrolled in ballet school. And she was so good that she made it into the Royal Ballet of London, which is quite an accomplishment, right? And after her career in the Royal Ballet, she opened up her own school, which is, unfortunately I don't know the name of the school, but it's one of the most famous ballet schools in London, right? All because she had a good psychiatrist who understood she was a dancer, right? And she went to the modern psychiatrist, she might be in a mental hospital right now. Not because she has ADHD, because the drugs that they gave her mental disease, right? So I really like that story. I can tell you another story. This is a great story. I have many Varnashram stories. I went to the Vyas Puja of Tamalkrishna Maharaj, and he was doing his dissertation, and he invited his professor to come. And his professor was sitting up on the stage with him. It wasn't a stage, but he was sitting. We were on the floor, and they were sitting in chairs. And they were going back with his professor talking and during the ceremony, and his professor was joking and the professor was speaking. And one thing I noticed about the professor is that this professor really liked being a professor. He was, you know, if you had to get a professor for a movie, you could just get him and just let him be natural, you know. You know, the professor with the hat and the pipe and yes, sir. You know, that kind of just, you know, just loves to read, loves to research, loves to speculate, loves to theorize. That's, you know, typical professor. They'd love that. And so I was looking at him and I was saying, I could just see that he loves being a professor. He was so happy. You could just see he was happy materially because he was in his dharma. I could see that, I could feel it, it was so obvious. You remember that? Remember it? You could just... In the audience were many devotees who were also UDOs, university dropouts. All married, all having to figure out how to make a living as a UDO. And one of the things that UDOs do to make a living is they find stuff. We could call, you have the word schlock? What's the British word for schlock? Schlock is like you go into a secondhand store and it's just full of like junk, you know. You gotta find, you know, a lot of the UDOs find something to sell. They just find something and sell it. You know? And most of these UDOs were actually Brahmins who were forced to find schlock, you know. It's, you know, whatever, it's find it, you know, find a toy and sell it. Find a this and go somewhere and sell it, you know. Set up in a mall and sell something. You know? And I was one of those UDOs who at that time was also doing that. So I knew the feeling of being displaced from your varna. And I was thinking, this is like so interesting. This professor, he's happier than all the devotees. At least in the terms of varna, because he's in his varna as a teacher, and they're not in their varna as teachers. They're in their varna as schlock salesmen. and they're all unhappy. And it was just like hit me like an arrow in the heart. I was like, wow. You know, so then I realized that one of the highest forms of happiness materially is to be in your varna, do what you like to do. That's according to your nature. That gives you a lot of happiness that you can't get from anything else. So the standard is, well, my daughter, want my son to be an engineer, to be this and that, that will have a secure job and make a lot of money, and therefore he'll be happy, but not necessarily. But if he's doing what he likes doing, he'll be happy. That's for sure, at least materially. So it's something to think about. Did that answer your question, or you need more?
Live in the car.
What?
Live in the car.
Yeah, but I think this is general. This is a general question, a general reply, general answer. But I think the analogy of the earth is very important. You know, we're just trying to get a few things out of the soil. You know, planting a few seeds. So education is geared towards science engineering, that's where everybody goes. But I joke with the Indians, I said, you know, if your parents figured out that you could make more money as a farmer, they would tell you to drop out of college and start farming, wouldn't they? Because it's all about money, and that's the problem. If it's about money and not about the individual, that's not what Krishna teaches. He teaches us about the individual nature. So Americans are much more like that, and that's the paradox. That India, the land of Bhagavad Gita, which teaches engage people according to varna, is where it's least applied. In America, where they don't even read Bhagavad Gita, they just naturally understand you should work according to your varna, your nature. Yes? Isn't that funny? The paradoxes that exist? That's a big one. There's another thing. If you have faith in your daughters, they'll be more successful than if you don't. So by releasing control, it shows faith, and they'll actually be more successful because they know you trust them. And then they're more inclined to do all the things you've told them to do because now they're on the spot because you've released them. Does that make sense? Yeah. If you tell her to do this, she can fail. But if you say, I know whatever choice you make, you'll be successful. Now it's like, whoa, I have to, because he's letting me on my own. And, but it's true, she will be. Okay. So work. All right, We had mentioned yesterday or the day before, Prabhupada said, don't work more than 8 hours a day. Not everybody can control that, but it was a general principle. We don't want to work so hard that it gets in the way of other things that are important. And usually, overworking gets in the way of sadhana. It actually gets in the way of everything, right? So that's a general principle. Obviously, we all can't control the number of hours we can work, but if we must work, but if we can control it, then you don't want your work to interfere with other aspects of your life. Right, Janava?
Yeah.
She has, yes. Okay.
That the varna is the original meaning of varna is not the Brahmins or Sudra. It is about the nature of the people grow.
Well, it's divided into the Brahma, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Sudra, but four distinct natures: intellectual.
But if I have a Sudra, but I would like to do all this puja and all sorts of things, or teaching, or spreading knowledge and understanding, then I could be a Brahmin.
Yeah. I mean, Prabhupada wants us to be brahminical. But the way you earn money will tend to be more according, it's better according to your nature. Because that's what you do most of the day. So we're all meant to be brahminical by culture. But occupation may not be. You know, let's say you're a businessman. If you're by nature a businessman, then Prabhupada said the nature of a Vaishya is they'll always think about making money. Even if they have enough, they'll still think about making it. But they can't stop because it's their nature. That's a Vaishya nature. So if you're a Vaishya, you'll probably start your own business. You won't want to work for somebody else because that's your nature. So you do that, and that's how you support yourself. And then you come to the temple, you love to do puja. That's your lifestyle. You know, brahminical is your lifestyle, and Vaishya is the way you earn a living because it's just natural to you. You know. How are you going to make money? I don't know. I'll just start a business. What kind of business? I don't know. Any business. I'll just make it work. That's Vaishya. You know, that business doesn't work, we'll do that one. He's not worried about it. And Shudra is just, give me a job. I'm comfortable. You know, it's just with a paycheck every month. That's Shudra. But Vaishya is like, I can't work for anybody else. It doesn't make any sense to a Vaishya. Why should I work for him and help him get rich? Right? But the Shudras, no, I'd rather, it's just simple. I just clock in, clock out, I have no worries, and I go home and I get a paycheck. And the Kshatriya is all about protection, you know, justice. And Brahman is all about knowledge and worship and enlightening people. There was a, this also answers your question, there was a creative writing class. And so one of the students was asking the teacher, how do you write? Like what do you do? You know, what kind of environment? How do you, and where do you get the inspiration? Is it the morning, the evening, at the desk, at the couch? Where do you get that inspiration? How do you, basically the question was, how do you write? You know, how do you just sit down and write? And the teacher thought, he couldn't answer the question. He says, I don't know how not to write. I've never been in a stage in my life where I wasn't writing. I can't answer that question. You know? So that's the nature of the Brahman. Like, where do you get the inspiration to teach? You know, I'm like teaching all the time. I teach in the car. When I get home, I teach. Right? Even when there's no one around, I'm teaching the walls. That's what I do. Right? So that's nature. So that's the Brahminical nature. So we all have a nature. And when we don't engage it, we're unhappy. So whatever your nature is, engage it in Krishna service. You may not be able to engage it in occupation because there's some restriction, the world's not perfect, but at least engage your nature in Krishna service, then you'll be inspired. If you say, well, I'm not really inspired, it might simply be you just haven't found a service that's in alignment with what your nature is. Right? We just heard some devotee who's a businessman. He got inspired by a project and he said, I'm going to start a second business and all that money will go to the project because he was so inspired. So he connected his nature to the inspiration of the project. He can't do the project. He doesn't even want to do the project, but he's inspired by it, so he's going to fund it. And he started a whole business just for that. Is that okay?
Yeah,
okay. So, work. The main idea here of work was not to allow work to infiltrate these other areas, which I think is more of a problem if you run your own business. Sometimes it's a problem for devotees, right? You work so hard, you neglect your sadhana, right? So seva then becomes the work that interferes with the sadhana. So Prabhupada said his father used to do puja till noon, go to work, and then come home at 6 and do more puja. He said, by trade he was a cloth salesman. He said, but actually his real business was puja. It seemed like his business was cloth. His real business was puja. It was worship. So it kind of goes with the idea of the 8 hours. You know, leave time in the morning, leave time in the evening. In the early days, Prabhupada said, in our movement is like a sandwich. Anyone heard this example? The ISKCON sandwich. The bottom piece of bread is your morning sadhana. The top piece of bread is your evening, and the middle is your service or your work. That's the sandwich. So your day should start hearing and chanting, and your evening should finish hearing and chanting, or in some programs. That's called the ISKCON sandwich. And another time Prabhupada said 9 to 5 are banking hours. Meant those are the hours for service, and then before and after hearing and chanting. That's the idea. Unless you're a manager or leader of ISKCON, your banking hours are like 4 a.m. till 11 at night, you know, 7 days a week. But we're trying to correct that, but we get very busy because we have a lot to do. But we have to balance that, right? Is that okay? Now, it's time for another story, because I know you like stories. A group of devotees came from Dubai to Alachua, and they knew me and said, could you arrange your workshop? And I said, yeah. And I think the workshop was about this, work-life balance. Right? So one of our godbrothers, Sesha Prabhu, did a little interactive session, and he said, if you had a job working 8 hours a day, and you were making sufficient money to live, but you got an offer to a job that some days could be up to 13 hours, and sometimes you might have to work occasionally on weekends, but it paid a lot more than your current job. It actually paid enough where you could send your kids to Harvard or MIT or Princeton or Yale or anywhere you wanted to send them. And it would upgrade your lifestyle. How many of you would take the job? Now, he was trying to make the point that we should keep life simple. And he was assuming everyone would raise their hand and say, no, I wouldn't take that job. And then he could go on and explain it. Having been preaching in Dubai, I knew everyone was going to say, I'll take the job. And they did. And he, you should have seen his face. He was caught completely off guard. He actually couldn't believe it. His face, the expression was, you're a devotee? And you would take a job that totally compromised your life, your sadhana, just for money? He was incredulous. He couldn't actually believe it. And I knew it was going to happen. There was no doubt in my mind they were going to say that. And it took him about an hour to convince them that they shouldn't take that job. They were like, but Prabhu, you know, I mean, I'll have more authority. People will respect me, you know, drive a nicer car, I'll be a higher position in the company. And Seisha's saying, but sometimes you're going to neglect, the whole weekend's gone, no service, no family. Some days you're working 13 hours, you're going to be schnicking to work and schnicking back from work. You know schnicking? Schnick, schnick, wam, mom, adi, adi. Schnick, schnick, wam, mom, adi, adi. Schnick, schnick, wam, mom, adi, adi. Schnick, schnick, wam, mom, adi. You're going to be doing that. Did you know, and there are 19 Puranas, not 18, in the 19th Purana it talks about Schnickaloka. And the Schnickadudas that take you to Schnickaloka, you didn't know that? Yeah. It's called the Mahatma Purana. The Mahatma Japa Course Purana. Yeah. So it actually took him a long time to convince them not to do that. So, in other words, if I could, his point was, if you can you have this amazing schedule where you can maintain your Krishna consciousness and you have enough money, why would you compromise it just to get more money? That was his point. And it took him quite a while to convince them. So, anyway, you like that story? Yeah, I want to ask you the same question, but I'll let you think about the question. It's a good question. So, then we have health. I'm too tired. You ever see that t-shirt? I'm too tired to exercise. You ever seen that?
Yeah.
What's funny about that? The reason you're tired is you don't exercise. So, this is an interesting topic because we're not the body, and so we're always concerned of what's too much or too little, right, for the body. That's going to be different for everybody. But Prabhupada was asked this a lot. And there's always a question. One time, the devotees were on the beach, they were taking a morning walk, and one man was doing a headstand. Headstand's good for your health, good for your brain. It's a good asana. And so devotees were kind of chiding him. Oh, Prabhupada, we don't do that. And Prabhupada said something like, yeah, because you're too lazy. You know, something like that, you know, because yeah, you think you don't need it, you know. So, then there was another time, and some devotee was like only eating raw food, and the devotees were trying to complain about that to Prabhupada. I just eat raw food, doesn't want to take prasada. He likes fasting and this and that. So, you know, Prabhupada said, you know, eat what's good for you, eat what's healthy. Fasting is good. And then when they finally put the question to Prabhupada, he said, you have to do something for your health. Just don't like become a fanatic that it, you know, takes all your time and energy and money. But we were fanatics the other way. We were neglecting it as young people, just serving. So obviously health is important because you need your body. So because we're not the body doesn't mean it's okay not to be healthy. Now, I don't want to scare you, but if I went to your home, I would predict that 90%, no, okay, I'll be generous, 75% of what's in your house is unhealthy. If you want to have some fun, take out your shampoo, put on your magnifying glasses so you can read what's in it, and go on Google those ingredients. You will throw it out immediately, most of your stuff. Did you know that? Do it with your toothpaste, your deodorant, your soaps, your microwaves. If you read anything about microwaves online, you will immediately throw it out. Actually, you'll find someone you don't like and say, hey, I have a microwave, do you want? Worst thing for you. Yeah. So, I'm not going to give you a lecture on health, but I know from my own study that many, 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 many things are bad for you. Now, I don't want to scare you and bum your day out, but wheat's not healthy. Did that make you unhappy? I have an Ayurvedic doctor. Don't eat wheat. Yes? Did you know that? Most wheat, it's not even wheat. It's who knows what it is. My son told me, he went to a seminar, he said, in America, there's opium in the wheat. Which would explain why it's hard to give up. This explains why you feel so good after you eat pizza. Anyway, you're all smart, so you understand. Some effort has to be made to maintain, so some time has to be set aside. Something. You want to do a test to see how old you are? It's a fun test. Everybody stand up, we're going to do a test. And I can tell you how old you are. And you can all stand up also. So, this is how you tell how old you are. Not from your birth certificate. You're going to keep your knees straight.
and you're going to bend down, right? And so if it's around here, you're like 108. And it's like here, you're like 99. This is like 89, 79. So if you can go flat on the ground like that, then you're like 17. So even if you're 85, but you can go flat, you have the body of a 17-year-old. Okay. So now we're going to go down slowly, slowly. And you're going to go down as far as you can. You have to keep your legs like hip apart straight. And go down, and you'll determine how old you are. And then we'll, after the exercise, we'll ask you how old you are. Okay? So everybody go down. Keep your legs straight. Down, down, down. Touch your toes. Touch the ground. Fingertips on the ground if you can. Flat. Oh, this girl's like 65. She only looks about 6. Okay. All right. So if you can only go to about here, if you can't touch your toes, you need to stretch. And according to yoga philosophy, when you get old, your body tightens, right? So if you do yoga and you keep it loose, if you're like a young man. Right. Should we do another one? I don't know if we should just kind of do this. We can pay obeisances on one leg. How many of you can stand on one leg? Yeah. This is a sign of getting old. The older you get, the harder it is. So that's awesome. Stretching, some yoga, some. Okay. Alright. We could do more if we wanted to, but it's not the best place. Yeah. So you all know how old you are now. But the good news is you can make yourself young very fast by stretching. Because your body is going to tighten up. As you get old, it's going to tighten up. Okay. So now we're going to do an exercise. And this is going to be a fun exercise like yesterday's. You're going to look at these four areas of your life. And you're going to look and say, which of these are out of balance? In other words, am I putting too much energy in one that's compromising another? Or am I giving priority to one where I should give priority to another? Am I giving priority to work where it should be sadhana? Or is my health really bad and I should be giving more priority to it, but I'm not. I'm giving priority to my service and my health isn't getting better. Something you need to balance, right? You just want to look at this equation, think about what we talked about. Maybe I need to be doing more service, or maybe I need to be doing more outreach and I'm not doing it. Everything else is good in my life, but I, you know, whenever they say Sankirtan, then I faint and I don't want to go out. We have a disciple like that. You say Sankirtan and he just passes out, basically. He doesn't like the sound. So you find some area in your life, if there is, which needs to be balanced, okay? Or a question you might have about this. You know, how could I make it more balanced, or should I make this more important or that more important? Then you're going to go around the room with your question, and you're going to ask every devotee, we don't have time, but you're going to ask as many devotees as we give you time and say, this is my problem. I am a workaholic. I chant my rounds while I drive and I just work 15 hours a day. What do I do? Or this is my problem. I don't spend time with my family. I just, you know, I stay, as soon as I come home from work, I just go to the temple and stay here till 11. And, you know, I love doing that, but my family's upset. What do I do? How do I deal with this? Because I love service. I don't want to give it up. But so you have these like dilemmas. So you present your dilemma to a devotee. You just go up and say, this is my dilemma, what should I do? And then they give you some suggestions. If you have a notebook, you write it down. And then they tell you their dilemma, and they say, okay, this is my dilemma, what do I do? Now, the nice thing about this exercise is if we do it long enough, somebody's going to come to you with the same dilemma you have, and you're going to have to instruct them how to solve it, which is really good. Because you'll also be getting the benefit of the instruction, right? Now, some of you may say, I don't even know what my dilemma is. I don't know if I'm out of balance. Maybe that's your question. Just like, can you help me know if I'm out of balance? I'm not sure. And say, okay, describe your life. Let's see. Couldn't you touch your toes? No, I could only touch my knees. Okay, well, you must be out of balance there. What else? How much money is in the bank? Well, I got a lot of bills. Any money? No, okay. You know, we got to look at work and, you know, maybe, you know, you need to rethink that. Something like that, okay? Is that all right? Anybody not clear what we're doing? Okay. You're going to have so much fun doing this exercise. You are going to, you're going to be talking about it for the rest of your life. So, you can go inside, outside, anywhere you just wander around, and you're going to ask a devotee, this is my challenge here, this area of my life is out of balance, and I need some guidance how to get it in balance. Or these two areas are out of balance, or three, or everything's out of balance. Or I don't even know what question to ask. Yeah, could be anything, and you'll get help from devotees. Okay, can we do it?
Yes.
Yes? Okay, let's go for it.
How much time do you
have? We'll let you know. It takes a while. You'll need a good... You'll need some time to do this, all right? So if you have your notebook and paper, you can ask. So we're going to end now. You can do this. You can do this exercise yourself. Okay? Because no need in looking at everybody, but I'll show them to you. You can see them. Here they are. Brisbane. And yes, we'll see you tomorrow morning, Bhagavatam class, which is at 7:30 our time in Brisbane. Hare Krishna.